let me have a dribble.
Welcome to House Call with Dr. Sean McCaffrey on Sports Radio 1450. Dr. McCaffrey is taking your calls, 529-1450. Now, this week's House Call with Dr. Sean McCaffrey on Sports Radio 1450 and sportsradio1450.com.
All right, good morning. I'm Dr. Sean McCaffrey. Listen to us live here in studio on House Call. I am in the fishbowl today with a few of our friends. Young man, how are you doing this morning?
Great. How are you doing?
I am doing well. Dr. Radloff's here in studio with me this morning, and we are up and chipper alert.
Ooh,
you're on your game. I saw you out there in the cold this morning.
Doing a little jog.
I thought it looked like in place.
Me.
Just
that
in place.
Me.
No, I know. I know. But I was hoping it was. I saw this people jogging. I thought, man, that guy's out there. He's working it. It wasn't you.
No.
That's okay.
Still a little chilly for me today.
You might get a little something by watching them, though.
Oh, no, I did.
You know, that's
got
to be a little bit of benefit.
Like, man, that's, oof.
Yeah. It looked cold. Looked cold to me. Robert, how are you this morning,
Doctor,
sir?
Pretty good. How are you?
I am well.
Good.
I am well. This could be a good year for your team.
Could be.
You have new headphones? These look new to me.
These are newer, yes. These were a Christmas present.
They're looking nice, dude.
My other one's broke.
Now, what sport does that team play?
Oh, my. Oh, man.
Dr. Radloff,
out.
It's all yours.
Out. And we're going to commercial break now.
Yeah. We have an hour. Oh, ESPN Radio's on.
Oh, look at that. You know, all right. I got to have a little fun with you. Come on. Okay. Hey, if you're going to be a Cub fan, you got to.
Oh,
it.
No, I know.
You know
I have just, for 27 years.
That is, yeah. Well, the good news is you're not alive longer than that. Or you'd be in real trouble.
I'm just glad he's here because at least he gets razzed, all right? So people don't realize how much I get razzed every day by this. Yeah.
I help
inch
you.
Inch of snow.
I help you, all right? I'm helping you. I'm preparing you for the real world. It is a hard time out there, all right?
Real
I'm making sure, his hide is thick.
You mean seasons?
Seasoned is good. I like that. Seasons, that's awesome. We have you well prepared. So I have fun with you. It makes my day a lot better.
I know.
I mean, it goes by
I
quick.
I know. That's what I'm here for, baby.
For those of you that are joining us for the first time, I'm Dr. Sean McCaffrey. Our show here is called House Call. We join you every Saturday morning with what we think is the best quality healthcare advice you can receive. It is a very holistic, natural approach to healthcare. We try to do things as naturally as possible. We'll deal with any question you want to throw at us, hopefully health ones, that you want to spin our way. Our phone number here is 529-1450. We are in our 16th year on the air here. The show, obviously, modifies itself as we go along.
Yeah.
I brought you on board, so that made things different. It'll make it somehow. We survive. We just keep going. We're like a glacier. We're always here.
Yeah, that's right.
You know,
slowly dying
slowly.
At the same time.
But we have fun, and that's the key to this. You know, healthcare is boring. There's no good way to do it. I mean, I've listened to, in the past, other doctors in the area have tried to do shows, and it's funny to listen to them. I mean, because it is... If you could hear paint drying, that's what it is. You know, it's like, whoo, because there's no way to fluff up or make it exciting.
No.
I mean, how exciting can you make oral surgery?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, one time, all right, it sounds pretty cool, but what do you do next week and the week after? And so we really try. We have such a broad-based practice, and we see so many different things, and we get such nice results that it gives us lots to talk about.
Yeah.
You know, and there's always people out there that have questions about things. And so you can contact us in a number of different ways. We've got a Facebook page. We have a web page. We're getting ready to do some things on there a little more grand. Dr. Radloff and I were discussing doing a webinar for other doctors at some point, and maybe just little short clips for listeners where you guys could kind of go through and hear things that we talk about. So I think it'll be fun. It'll be something worth doing. It should be exciting for you. So I hope you enjoy it. And this is why we do the show. It makes it a lot of fun. So we start it all out with all the good stuff. Let's see what's happening in the headlines around the globe. All right, strike one up for evolution. Apparently, there's a reason guys like curves. You can't go wrong with this one.
Hey, yeah, we were talking about this.
When I run into a good, I got to bring this one up. This is a good one. for years, I guess, humanity has wondered why men are attracted to certain physical features on women. And curves are one of these. And ironically, it's the buttock area they're talking about here. It's the lumbar curve, the low back curve. And what was funny about this is that they were noting that it doesn't matter on the physical size of the individual that you're looking at. It's that angle, that curve. There's something about the curve that on a core animalistic thing draws male attention. And they were going through this and looking at this, and they said, you know, it's modified itself over thousands of years to become this way, but that spinal structure enabled women to be able to be pregnant and have children, but at the same time survive.
Right.
And that was a big thing. You know, they could, because the angle allows for easier balance, mm-hmm. and what was interesting is it was showing that the center of gravity when pregnant, when that curve is in place, it allows them to stay more balanced. Which is interesting because in theory, then it allowed them to run from the large cat that was chasing them. So the ones that didn't have that balance, they fall down. It's like a horror movie, you know, they never get away. But it was interesting that they took different people and they changed weight and physical look, you know, in different sizes. And they went through different clothing, like, you know, a 2 versus a 12 versus a 20. And they found that as long as that angle was in place, it didn't matter on the actual physical look, that guys were attracted to that no matter what. And they showed different looks at random. It was very, very interesting that you have this kind of hardwired nature about you, and then it goes with an anatomical feature, in this case, a spinal curve. Well, for us, you know, I'm thinking spinal anatomy. I'm all over this, you know. But it was interesting that it was 45.5 degrees. That was the curvature of the lumbar spine.
Like, come here, girl. Let me measure this.
It was very.
You're gonna have all these people coming in, and be like, "Hey, doc, can you
curve good? Can you help this?
Can we?"
You know, but it was very funny that, you know, it's interesting that when you look at that curve, that when women are having a baby or something of that nature, that if they have that curve, the baby delivery time is easier
on them.
You know, it's not as hard on them physically. I'm guessing the mortality rate would be tied to that as well of the mother, especially thousands of years ago, that if the curve was, you know, less than that, then the mortality rate goes up.
Yeah.
So it's very interesting, you know, that we're designed a certain way, and, you know, we look at all these things that we have and features and this and that that people like, but down on the, I guess, the core root of how we're made, nature said, look, I'm gonna let you find a way to give you something you can really cue in on for survival. So it's interesting. Yeah. You know, it was an interesting thought, food for thought, something to think about there. Doc, what do you got in the news?
Oh, this is kind of most people should know a little bit about this, but it's interesting how they've related this study here. So they said babies who are breastfed for at least 1 year grow up to be significantly smarter, but not only smarter, they actually make more money. So it was funny, they followed these people for 30 years. They had 6,000 people in this study. And they said participants who were breastfed for 12 months or more had higher IQs, more years of education, and higher monthly incomes than those who did not.
Yeah, and there's a correlation there, obviously. Yeah. That if you have a higher intelligence level, the odds of you getting a better paying job go up, you know, because that makes sense. But, you know, it's interesting when you look at something like that, because breastfeeding, when I was a kid, boy, they were hammering it.
Yeah.
Don't do it.
I know.
Go to formula. Blah, blah, blah. I'm like, you can't beat Mother Nature. No, I know. You can't beat Mother Nature. And it's interesting that the nutrients that we get, there's something called epigenetics, how we pass things down through fluids, through tissue and things like that. That's involved here. And now they're showing you that if you have the luxury of doing that, that it benefits the child in the long run. So that's exciting. And then, you know, to think that economically it benefits you. Yeah. And again, partly I'm guessing because the intelligence level goes up a little bit. It's very interesting. Very interesting food for thought. Great article, Doc. All right, let's take a caller here if we've got one. Our phone number, guys, is 529-1450. Caller, good morning. How are you?
Hi, I'm fine.
Well, that's not a cheerful fine. What can I do for you?
This is Jody. You know who this is.
Okay, yeah.
From yesterday, right?
Yes, you're going to come visit me today.
I am, if I can.
That's fine. Yeah, I'll be in there. I'll be there 9 o'clock. Give me 9:10. Can you do that?
I could probably make it around 9:30. I'll have to leave work and head up that way.
Yep, we'll be there.
9:30 okay with you?
Yeah, that'd be fine. We'll be there and we'll work on you then, okay?
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
You're welcome, hon. Thank you. All right, bye-bye. Patient, there's a good one. We'll use her as an example. She came in yesterday, and they're getting ready to go on a trip and things like this, and had some problems with the low back, leg, and things like that, like a sciatica type thing. It flared up, and I'm like, you know what, give me a buzz tomorrow if you need it. She could have done it off air. That's okay. We won't give her a hard time for that. It's funny. It makes for good conversation. But I'll see you as soon as I'm off the air. And we'll
she
go
wanted to
office.
Make sure she's like, I'm that's, talking to him right,
right.
now
I'm
because you're
going to
see me.
That's exactly right. So I will see you at the office. That's funny. All right, guys, we have to take a quick break. We'll be back in just a moment. All right, guys, welcome back here to House Call. Our phone number is 529-1450, 529-1450. Okay, let's see what else we've got here.
Oh, I got to give you a quick shout-out real quick.
Give me a quick shout-out.
Quick shout-out. So Doc is a great, great guy, first off. This one, I want you to know that.
I like this. It's starting out well. Keep going.
We went to the Style of Hope Rock the Runway fashion show.
We did.
A few days ago. It was a great, great cause, you know, and Doc has – have you supported them for more than 1 year?
You know, this is our first big year. We got invited to it. It's a charity event for children. It took place downtown the convention center. They had over 400 people there. It was a lot of people for a charity event.
And I believe our very own Andy Brooks from 104.5 WFMB walked the runway.
Very nice.
Yeah. Yes.
Very nice.
We also had someone else walk the runway.
My wife walked the runway, which was fun to watch. That's always a good time. It's a great event. And you know, I like charities. If I'm gonna do one, I get pulled in by the kid ones.
Yeah,
you know, I do stuff with March of Dimes. I do things like that. I really enjoy those.
Well, at the very end, you know, it pulls at the heart a little bit, you know, because they dress some of these kids up and stuff at the very end and let them rock you know, the runway with everyone. And I mean, you could tell just how happy it made them, you know.
Sure, absolutely.
It was a good cause.
It is a good cause. Yeah. You know, we took the office. I've got the staff that works with us, and we buy a section through there, and we take the office, and we donate. You got your silent auctions and things that you do, and it's a great cause. And it's something that, you know, Springfield has a lot of really good charities that they do. A lot of people are involved. You know, several of our patients are involved in things, and we see them. You know, I see Julie Zara everywhere. She's one, 'cause she's involved in everything. It's amazing that young lady's involved in so much stuff. But it's great, you know. I mean, we do young philanthropists. We do a lot of things like that where you can give back. Mm-hmm. And that's one of the things that we try to do. Speaking of that, you know, we're getting ready to start this. Mm-hmm. Next month in April, we're extending our hours out now. Dr. Radloff has decided he doesn't like a 40-hour work week. He'd like 60. So I'm going to let him do that. I'm not going to fight him on that urge. But he's like, I need to be there more. I'm like, okay, hey.
Whatever you 40's want, man.
Not enough,
whatever
man.
You
need
man.
Double that. But we're going to open up our hours a little bit. We're going to do some Saturday morning stuff for people that need help, like we're going to be over there anyway.
Yeah.
So that works out.
Not necessarily
it's
new.
Kind of how it happens anyway. But, you know, we're going to do a segment that is something I've thought about doing for a very long time.
Yeah.
And now that I have him on board as a partner, it's something we can offer. We're going to do a first responders weekend. Mm-hmm. And we'll do it every month. It'll
probably be the third
Saturday of the month. We get off the show, we'll go over there, and if you're a first responder in any of those fields, come in, we'll take care of you.
Yeah.
And we'll do a little, we'll set it up in a way that people understand how we do it and why we do it. I think it's a good idea. It's something that it's a way of giving back to the community. I am obviously very pro.
Yeah.
I'm pro military. I'm pro law enforcement. Yeah. I'm pro, ambulance service, firefighters. I just think it's a great thing. And you know, these guys get hurt, and women too. I mean, they get hurt. And so if you can help them and get the quality of life back, it's worth doing.
Yeah.
So we're going to offer that. We'll announce it every week or two prior to, we'll talk about it. Hey, it's coming up, our first responder Saturday. We're going to do it the third week of April, which should be good. The third Saturday. So I think it'll be a lot of fun, and we'll talk about it, and hopefully we'll have a nice little turnout. For
I just wanted people to know that you're not only brilliant, but you're a great, great person too. So.
Well, thanks. The brilliant part could be argued greatly.
Is someone's performance review coming?
You know,
at you?
I know. I'm in here with my paddle and my boots right now, wading through, but it's okay. Well, thanks, fella. I appreciate it. You know, we just have a good time, and part of, you know, it's why we do the radio show as well. It's to give you little bits of information. You know, like some of it's silly, you know, I mean, the evolutionary thing with the curves. It's funny, though, and it's true. Yeah. You know, it's science. It's anatomy. And it's telling you this is why we do certain things that we do. You know, when you go over to the concept of breastfeeding yeah. and what it does for you. And so far, we've got curves and breastfeeding out of the way this morning.
Wow.
I've got one more in that same vein. I don't know how we got there. We might as well go with this, I guess, since we're down that road already. Too funny. All right, guys, here we go. If you'd like to have a more active sex life, you need to get more sleep.
Woo.
And this aims for the young lady. Women who sleep more are a lot more likely to do other things, as it says in the article. It comes out of the University of Michigan in a sleep and circadian research study that they were doing. They followed college-age women over a period of several weeks, and they noted that those who had more sleep had a more fulfilling, intimate life with their partners, which was interesting. Every extra hour of sleep raised the likelihood for having some type of an intimate relationship by 14% the next day. Crickets.
Yeah.
Ladies sleep. Okay. That's pretty good. You know, you think about that. You're like, all right, if I get an extra hour of sleep, it increases your odds of having fun.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm thinking, all right. 6, 10, 12 extra hours of sleep. My odds go up by about 90% if I figure this right. That's exactly right.
You're going to have all these guys now, but honey, go back to bed right now. Go back to bed.
Don't listen to his show. Go back to sleep. Really,
we'll get it. We'll listen to it later.
It's on tape delay. We can hear it. It's so funny. But it's funny when you look at little studies like this, and you know this. It's produced in the Journal of Sexual Medicine that's coming out this week. It's not been looked at since the 1960s.
Wow.
You know, so it's like we did something 50 years ago and decided, well, that's how it is.
Yeah.
And now they're like, wait a minute here. There's some, but you know, all these little things that are tying together, and this is just what's in the news this week, but all these little things that are tying together, you look at that and you look, okay, healthcare. How does any of this apply to healthcare?
Yeah.
All right. Hugs, touching, kissing, the they talked about. The emotional aspect of healthcare is huge.
Yeah,
it is the most overlooked portion of someone's overall health of anything out there.
Mm-hmm.
We all look at the anatomy and the physiology and the biochemistry, but we forget about what emotions do to the body. And being in a relationship with somebody, you know, we've all been there. You know, you like somebody, you get that crush, and you're like, oh my gosh,
you can't get enough of them.
You know, I mean, you're just like, oh my God, you want to flirt and be all playful and this and that. It makes you feel good. It does good things for you. You know, what happens when it goes the other way?
Yeah. Oh.
How do you feel? Right? Miserable. You don't feel good. Listen to any radio station, okay? It's either the person that wrote the song is on the high end or they're on the low. You know, that's what you're hearing. You're hearing, hey, this is great, or oh, it's terrible. But that's what songs are, right? They're poetry like that, and that's why they affect so many people. So we look at this and we think, gosh, you know, little simple things.
Mm-hmm.
Holding hands, touching, all the...
Touch is huge.
It's huge. I mean, absolutely huge. You know, it's one of the reasons I think that our profession is so very successful. It's a very hands-on profession.
Constantly.
It's not cold and sterile. You know, you're tied into somebody. There's something about, you know, I mean, you pet a dog.
Yeah.
It makes you feel better.
Yeah.
That's just how it is. I mean, they're loving, they're caring, it just makes you feel better. So when you're helping someone who doesn't feel good...
Mm-hmm.
It's important. You know, I saw a thing on the Dalai Lama years ago, and he was helping people, and he was healing, and he made a point of touching them knee to knee.
Mm-hmm.
He would make sure when they were sitting down, his knee was touching theirs. So there was that contact before he'd ever start to talk to them. He made that initial contact because it puts you at ease.
Yeah.
It calms the body down, and they've done so much work with touch therapies.
Yeah.
Massage is wonderful, even PT, you know, when they're touching. As long as there's that hands-on, people tend to respond better than when it's cold and stagnant.
Mm-hmm.
So it shows you here that this week in the news, obviously between what we're finding,
there's
lots of stuff talking about anatomy, talking about sensualness and sexuality and how the body interacts, but it's talking about emotions and how important that is for your overall health. So there's a lot of good things. Doc, you got anything else in there?
Yeah, this one's pretty interesting too. So lighting adjustments necessary for better health, research says. They talk about how the lighting affects your sleep cycles and all that stuff, and They said it's becoming clear that typical lighting is affecting our physiology. By that, we mean dimmer and longer wavelengths in the evening and avoiding the bright blue hues of the e-reader tablets on all of our little phones. They're actually starting to link this not only to sleep patterns, but they say that the long-term effects they're starting to notice are breast cancer, obesity, diabetes, depression, and possibly linked to different cancers.
Yeah, so you go through those. None of those sound like something
no,
I want.
No.
You know, here, give me a nice thing of obesity with some cancer.
Well, I mean, but you look at how many people do you see locked in to an iPad, an iPhone, something. I mean,
especially
they don't
at
off.
Night.
Yeah,
you know, you work all day, you get home, you sit down, and you're reading a book on it. Or you're reading the newspaper, you're playing a game, or you're doing something like you see it all the time.
So not only do you have the implication of, hey, I can't sleep now because this is messing up my whole sleep cycle, but then long term it's like.
And if you're female and doing it,
yeah.
What happens when they don't sleep?
Yeah.
I'm just saying. There it is. Sleep, girls. Sleep.
Okay. Leave it to you.
See? You tie all this together. It's a health show. We tie all this together. Too much fun. That's awesome. All right, guys. Our phone number here is 529-1450. If you have a health question or something like that you'd like us to help you with, just give us a buzz. We'll be back in just a moment. I'm telling you here, we work this song in with our sleepy time, and we're doing good.
That and the breast milk and everything.
Yeah, we're good. We're good. All right, welcome back here to House Call. Again, our phone number is 529-1450. Hey, Doc, did you know this? There's a we want to thank our sponsors real quick. Let's do that first, I guess. Apple Barn, Belterra Farms, Gracie Baja, and the Body Quest store over on Montvale. So we're going to be thanking these guys. We'll try and see if we can get a hold of Dave here in a little bit. This is an interesting thing that came out this week. They've got a new blood test, and this is actually a good thing. They found a protein that is left behind by a virus when it gets going crazy in the body.
Hmm.
So when a virus ramps up and goes nuts, it leaves this protein trail that they now can find on a blood test. When a bacteria ramps up, it doesn't leave the trail.
Hmm.
So if you end up going into the doctor's office and you're sitting there and you're sick and you're hacking and you're coughing and you're wheezing and they're like, we don't know what you have, because that's all they're doing. They're just guessing, right? Yeah. They're guessing 99% of the time. Well, if they give you an antibiotic and it's a virus, it's worthless.
Yeah.
And it ends up creating superbugs and antibiotic resistant, you know, different things. And there's been a big problem with this in the past several decades.
Yeah.
Well, this new blood test is over 90% accurate so far from what they found. And it seems to let them know, look, it's either a virus or it's a bacteria.
Mm-hmm.
So what's nice about that is that within 2 hours of doing it, they can tell you, oh, it's a bacteria. Here's your antibiotic. Let's get it out of there.
Yeah.
Or, oh, it's a virus. We can't touch it with this. We're not going to issue the antibiotic because it won't work, and it'll end up creating more problems down the road. And this has been a huge issue for us. It was done in Israel. They took 1,000 patients and ran this. It was very interesting, though, that they're following a protein trail left behind by the virus. As it moves around and does things. So it's exciting in some ways because we look at this and we think, oh, wow, okay. So now we actually have something we can physically track and see and say, wow, it's there, it's not. And if it's there, we know, all right, we should not give you an antibiotic. If it's not there, then there's a good chance we can get away with the antibiotic and it'll help you heal and get better faster.
That reminds me, I won't get off on the soapbox or anything, but, you know, with UTIs and stuff, how quick they are to –
way too fast.
Yeah. You know, I'm not against any of the stuff or anything like that, obviously, but make sure, you know, hey, is there really an organism in there? Because if not, the antibiotic's not going to do anything for you. Anyway.
Correct. You know, it's interesting that you say that, too, because urinary tract infections, you know, Dr. Loomis and I and a few other doctors did work on this several years back.
Uh-huh.
We looked at 3,500 urine cultures and tests of diagnosed urinary tract infections.
Mm-hmm.
These are people, you got it. You got a urinary, you were given an antibiotic. Here it is. We collected the urine sample off of that. Zero infections, not one. In 3,500 samples,
that were
not
old.
One actually had an infection. They all, however, had abnormal pH. The bladder was a little bit alkaline.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and you hear that all the time. People are always talking about acid-base, and I want to be more alkaline. Acid's bad for you. No, you don't. You want to be in the middle. Okay. Parts of the body want to be a little more acidic. Parts of the body want to be a little more alkaline. You don't want to force the body either direction a lot, because if you do, you set it up for problems. Yeah. You know, yes, you'll see more cancers in acidic bodies, but you see more chronic arthritis and other degenerative diseases in alkaline bodies. Mm-hmm. So you look at these things.
And stuff
absolutely.
Like
absolutely. They get just as many problems as anybody else. You know, so we look at something like this and what you were saying about that. It's about a balance. You know, when you're looking at the urinary tract, because we've seen three or four of those
recently.
We had three or four people come in that had urinary tract issues. It's about balancing that out. You check the pH of the urine. If it's a little too high, and for if you don't understand acid, base, alkaline, and all that stuff, just think hot and cold, okay? We're going to really make it simplistic. Acid's hot. Ooh, it burns you, right? Mm-hmm. Alkaline is cold. But if something is really, really cold, it almost feels like it's burning you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, when it's so it works that way. So too much of either one is not a good thing. You want it to kind of be lukewarm, somewhere in the middle, or just slightly cool. So when you're looking at this stuff and you're thinking about that, you think, okay, if my bladder is designed to hold an acid, and that's really what it's made for, it's designed to hold something of a pH between 6.3 and 6.6, 6.7. If you go above that, you start becoming alkaline. Well, that tissue in the bladder says, look, I'm designed to hold acid. I'm designed to hold hot. Mm-hmm. If you go putting a bunch of cold in me, it actually damages the lining a little bit. Mm-hmm. It burns it, for lack of better words. And when you scald the lining, just like it's like eating a bowl of Cap'n Crunch, right? Yeah. You know you're going to tear up that mouth.
Yeah. But it's so delicious.
When you scald that bladder a little bit, you burn it. The first thing that happens when it gets burned, it's like a floor burn.
Yep.
Red blood cells. You immediately see red blood cells. Boom. They start popping into the urine because that's where it's at. The second thing that happens, the body moves the immune system in there to fix it. Mm-hmm. So here come the white blood cells. So now you've got red and white blood cells on a urine dip that they're doing. Oh, you've got an infection. Here's your antibiotic. No.
And that's why people go two, three rounds.
You have irritation down there. You need to get rid of the irritation, and then all the red and the white blood cells go away. Mm-hmm. The tissue heals, and magically you fix a urinary tract infection. It's unbelievable. Let's take a couple callers here. Caller, good morning. You're on House Call. What can I do for you?
Good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
I just was wondering, I'm having a problem with the corners of my mouth.
Okay.
And it started with the fever blister.
Uh-huh.
And I treated that, and it just didn't seem, it lingered and lingered. And, of course, the treatment said just no more than 5 days.
Right.
So then I switched, and I thought, well, let's try coconut oil. Because it was kind of dry around there.
Uh-huh.
And that seemed to help for a while, but then I finally went back to the over-the-counter Abreva stuff, and it seems to be working now. But what causes it? Am I eating too much acid food?
Well, you know, you kind of answered it yourself there when you said that it started with a fever blister. It didn't quite go away. You went to the coconut oil, which is soothing to it. It'll kind of calm it down a little bit, but it stayed around. And then you went back to Abreva. Abreva, for those of you that don't know, it's a topical over-the-counter product, like a lotion, but it's used for a herpes-type virus is where it's effective. And that's what a cold sore is. A cold sore is just a family of the herpes virus. It's the same thing that causes chicken pox and shingles and all that. They're all in that same family together. Yep. It's a liver issue. When you get cracks in the corner of the mouth, you ever see that, and they're repetitive. They're coming all the time. They won't go away. You're looking at the liver. The liver's telling you, look, I can't keep up with what's going on right now inside the body. And his job is to filter and clean you. It's not able to keep up. That virus loves to harbor itself away in the liver.
Yeah.
So anytime you ever see any kind of a herpes-type infection, a shingles, a chicken pox, a cold sore, fever blister, anything like that, you always, always go and look at the liver because that's where your problem is. So you have to get the liver cleaned out and functioning. And it's not that it's not working. It's just not optimal. All right. Maybe it's running at 70% instead of 90. You want to get it running more optimal. And as soon as you clean that up, all of it will stop. It'll go away.
What can I do?
The first thing I would probably do, I would probably flush it a little bit. You know, do something real gentle. You got to be careful with lemon water, but because of the cracks, it may burn a little bit. But since you're doing it internally, it shouldn't bother you. I do lemon water. I just flush it with that. You know, put some lemon through there. And the lemon has alkaline minerals in it, and alkaline minerals act as a methyl donor for the liver to make it work better. So you just simply go buy 4 or 5 lemons, cut them into quarters. Do a quarter, take 1/4 lemon, squeeze all the juice you can out of it in about 8 to 10 ounces of warm water. Do it in the morning and do it again at night and do it for about a week. And that'll help getting that liver to kind of get working a little bit better, okay? It's like putting
flush it out?
Yeah, it's like putting vinegar through a coffee pot, you know, to clean it out every now and then and get rid of all
sure.
the...
Right.
It's the same thing. You're just going to kind of flush it a little bit. You start there. If that does it, you're home free, it's over. If it doesn't do it, then you got to go after it. You got to go hunt that virus a little bit. You have to get the body to recognize that the virus is there and that your immune system, for some reason, is ignoring it. So you have to kind of get it to see it. And that's just a matter of you come in and we do a couple things and we'll get the body to kind of recognize it a little bit easier. Once it recognizes it, it'll knock it right out.
Okay, that's a quarter of a lemon?
Yep. Squeeze all the juice you can out of it in about 8 to 10 ounces of warm water.
And that's twice a day?
Yep, morning and night.
Okay, thank you so much.
All right, you're welcome. Thank you
really
for your call.
I'm really tired of fighting
now. I understand.
Okay.
Thank you for your call. I appreciate it. And again, the Breva will help a little bit topically because it's going to help that tissue at the surface heal, but it's an internal problem. Mm-hmm. That's why when you start getting skin things of any kind, you get any skin condition at all, start thinking, all right, if I didn't rub up against something, then it's inside me. Mm-hmm. Okay, and you just got to go hunt for it where it could be. All right, let's see what else we've got here. We did the antibiotics. We did that. We have another caller. Let's take a caller then. Caller, good morning. You're on house call. What can I do for you?
Yes, doctor. Have you heard of a supplement called hops?
Hops. Yes, I want to say so. Let me think
because,
of how.
You know, you were talking about beer last week, and I thought, well, hops is the main ingredient in your beer.
It is. You're correct. You're absolutely correct on that. That's funny. Yes, you know, it's the same concept as like a yeast or something of that nature. I'll come back to it for you. We'll talk about it because we're going to have to break here in just a second, and we'll go over it for you when we come back. Is that okay?
Okay, I'll hang up.
All right, thank you very much. Take care, guys. All right, we'll be back in just a moment. All right, guys, welcome back here to House Call. Again, our phone number here is 529-1450. You listen to us live here on 1450 WFMB.
Look at that.
Wow. You like that?
No, WFMB.
I feel good. I see Robert over here looking. He's thinking, that was fantastic. The delivery, wasn't it? It was about the delivery. It was the B.
All about the delivery, yeah.
I knew. It was good.
It's a good radio voice.
You do have a radio voice.
No, you. Not
no,
me.
I do not. It's funny. We'll run into people periodically. We were at this fundraiser the other night, and I saw a patient that I hadn't seen in years. Mm-hmm. I knew her, but I couldn't put the name to it. And I walk up to her, and I'm like, boy, I'm sorry. I know you. I just can't. And a gentleman was with her, and he goes, well, who are you? Because I didn't know him. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, I'm so-and-so. He goes, oh, you do the radio show every Saturday morning, because he knew my voice right away. And you don't think about that when you're on the air all the time. That's all people hear.
Yeah, your voice.
And so they kind of get used to your voice. And in my head, it doesn't sound that great. You know, when I hear my voice, I'm like, yeah, it's not that spectacular. But it's funny how people recognize you that way.
Yep.
And it's fun. You know, we're in the room, and it's kind of neat in some ways because I'm a hat guy. You know, I wear hats. Mm-hmm. If I had a full head of hair or no hair, I'm still a hat guy.
Yeah.
I always have been, you know, since I was a kid. It's just what I do. So when I'm out of the office and I'm out and about, I've always got a ball cap on or something of that nature. Ball caps make you look younger.
Mm-hmm.
And so I can knock 15 years off me pretty quick in a ball cap. Nobody knows who I am. I mean, I will stand in line behind people at a store or something that are patients of mine. And they do not recognize me. And I'll be like, hey, how you doing? And they're like, oh my gosh. Or if I talk, they can hear the voice and they know.
Yeah.
But it's funny because I can kind of hide. You know, I'm a little incognito.
I was going to say incognito.
That's right. But it makes it a lot of fun. All right, let's see what's happening for the 2-minute warning this time.
Woo, here we go. Good morning, all you wonderful sports fans out there. I hope you are having a great, safe, wonderful weekend. The weather's going to be a little bit better this weekend, so we'll see. No scores today, so we're going to talk about my Oklahoma City Thunder, even though Doc, no, yeah, he's shaking his head over here. Yeah, I know, they're struggling. And my boy Kevin Durant, he's struggling big time, I think, out a little bit indefinitely here. So what had happened last year is he had a surgery to repair a broken bone in his foot. Okay, and obviously they say they blame it on a screw now that's given him a little problem. So they went back in again. Okay, when you have something that invasive of a surgery, what happens is muscles and ligaments and all that stuff surrounding that area, all right, tend to kind of give out. So think of it like a fuse box. You've had a few fuses that have popped now. So every time he goes to play on that, he blows some of those fuses, and all of a sudden the body's like, hey, I can't, the muscles can't maintain the function that they need to, okay? What you do, all right, well, we do, me, you, us, what we do is we go in there and we'll say, hey, we'll turn that fuse back on, all right? You start turning fuses back on, that adds stability to that area, okay? So that allows them to heal faster. That allows them to get back to playing sooner, all right? So I think he needs to give us a little call here.
I would agree with you there.
I think that would get him back playing a little bit faster here.
Let's take this up a notch here. So we're looking at a guy, you're talking a multi-million dollar athlete that had a foot problem. How do you get the foot problem?
Yeah.
The muscles had to quit to begin with. That's the only way it happens, guys. You're not going to see an ankle injury, a knee injury, a hip, a shoulder, a wrist, an elbow. You're never, ever, ever, ever going to see one of those where a muscle has not failed before the joint got in trouble. So before you need a knee replacement, before you're bone on bone, which is my favorite term, before you're there, the muscles had to quit. Something went wrong. They are the ones that stabilize this. The body lost the ability. It lost... Think like a computer, okay? You lost the driver.
Yeah.
Somewhere in there, you got an error message, and the brain goes, well, that driver's gone. It no longer does that function. You have to retrain it. You got to reinstall that. That's what we call it, the ABCs, right? You teach the body all over again. And with Kevin Durant here, you're talking, the guy was the MVP, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Multi-million dollar athlete, okay? A phenomenal basketball player. He's in trouble, and he's getting the best care out there. Well, almost the best care out there, and it's not good enough, you know, because they're looking at the wrong thing. So it goes with anything. You don't have to be a $30 million a year athlete.
No.
You can be Joe Blow in a tractor on a farm that hops out and catches one of those dirt clods funny, and all of a sudden, oh, I rolled that ankle, or my knee hurts now because I did that. We had a gentleman in the office the other day that was talking to me, and he was talking about a knee problem that he had. And he's like, you know, I want to lose some weight. I've got a knee issue. You know, my doctor says I've already had surgery on the knee four separate times.
Mm-hmm.
So what does that tell you right there?
Yeah. You are,
he's not 45 years old. And I'm like, okay, 45 years and four knee surgeries. Whew, there's a problem there. You know, I get it. There could be an injury. I'm not against that. You could have some catastrophic thing that happened. You got hit by a bus.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, all right, you blew past what the muscles could do. You got into the ligaments. You caused all this damage. That happens. But when you're looking at everyday life and you're sitting there and you're going, oh, I tore my MCL or I tore this or I tore that, why?
Yeah.
Why would it tear? Knees are designed to bend and twist and turn and get kinked. Why would it tear? And you know, it's funny, all these people get these surgeries done and they come in to see us 6 years later and like, well, I still got that knee problem that
Or they've had three other, like this guy. I mean, because there's a lady the other day too, same thing.
All right. Yep.
Two knees, an ankle, and then back.
Yep. And you look at that and you think to yourself, okay, there's nothing wrong with the surgeries. I know several surgeons here in town. I'm friends with a bunch of them. They do great work. Okay. Surgeries are perfect when you have big tears and catastrophic issues. But you have to go back then when you're all said and done and get that joint stable. And the only way to do that is the muscles have to do it. But it's not about lifting and stretching and this and that. If a muscle gets to the point where it says, hey, I'm going to tear or I'm going to let go of the rope. Yep. It decides to let go a lot more than it decides to tear. Thank God. You know, because otherwise we'd all be under the knife every other minute.
Mm-hmm.
So it lets go of the rope. Once it lets go, once you teach it that bad habit, it's like having a dog. Once you let it go potty on the carpet,
hello's a dog.
All right, the dog wants to go potty on the carpet.
Yep.
You got to retrain it.
Mm-hmm.
And muscles are no different. It gets that bad habit. You have to retrain it. And it's not about going to a gym and lifting weights. That's not part of this. It's going through and saying, okay, in the nervous system, it literally shut the light switch off. And so we're all in there with light bulbs trying to get the lights to come on. And nobody's like, well, go turn on the switch. That's all you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it works that way with Derrick Rose playing right now. It works that way with Kevin Durant. It works that way with little Susie Homemaker that
I was going to say my mom
fell down the stairs or missed a step or slipped in the ice. It's no different. It doesn't matter what stage of life you're in. The body says, look, you hurt me. You didn't fix me. I'm going to adapt.
Mm-hmm.
And so it adapts. And when it adapts, now it's not quite right. It's not perfect anymore. Now it's adapted to what was wrong. You didn't fix it. I'm going to shift a little bit and turn my body a little funny so I can get the pressure off of it.
Yeah.
But if I'm playing up and down a court or I'm mowing a yard or I'm out raking leaves or I'm doing laundry and going up and down a flight of stairs, if I'm adapted, I can't do it as much.
Yep.
And all
especially
of a sudden,
when you start fatiguing it
you
out
got
like
it.
These guys.
That's it.
They once, can do it for a while, but all of a sudden you start loading it up and the body says, hey, I can't take it anymore.
That's exactly right. And once that fatigue sets in, bang, now another muscle fails, and that's when you get injured. And they're sitting there, and these guys are missing seasons. They're missing all these things. One of the doctors that taught Dr. Radloff and myself that mentored us, he was with the professional basketball team for 25 years. Mm-hmm. Their injury rate was 70% lower than the rest of the league over a 25-year period.
Yeah.
That's phenomenal. That's yeah. unbelievable. If you could walk in and say, hey, you know, we can do – it's unbelievable. And so the gentleman that came in with the knee problem, I immediately focused on that. I'm like, do you want it to go away?
Yeah.
Do you want to feel, I'd love for it to feel better, but they told me I got nothing left. Yeah. They're waiting for it to have surgery, but he's too young to have it. So the doc's like, just wait.
We've
and
heard
I get that.
Several times
I get
too,
that.
Man.
I understand That's, it, but it's like, okay, so you're going to be miserable for the next 2 decades?
Until they can do surgery.
And then it's still going to be miserable. Mm-hmm. No, I don't buy that. I'm like, dude, how fast do you want it fixed? Mm-hmm. That's all it comes down to me. You know, we restore the car. How fast do you want us to restore it to showroom new? That's
and
what we're
like,
after.
And just like, you know, I like your analogy too with, you know, restoration and all that. When you start looking at that, this is not you don't restore a car overnight. All right, it takes a little bit.
It does. It takes some time and it takes some effort. But you know, if you're willing to put it in, we can get that puppy running. That's what
right.
we're doing. Let's see what the witch doctor's got going on.
I told the witch doctor I was in love with you. And then the witch doctor he told me what to do. He said that.
All right, guys, here we go. Did you know this simple little remedy may reduce a pesky headache? Headaches are one of the most common reasons people seek out someone in the healthcare profession. In the United States alone, over $100 billion is spent yearly in an effort to relieve the pain. All too often, many of the costly treatments offer little or no real true relief. A University of Hawaii study has found that a combination of hot and cold therapy can be very effective at soothing these headaches, though. The researchers noted that placing an ice pack on your throat while soaking your feet in hot water could reduce head pain by 45% in as little as 30 minutes.
Wow.
That's amazing.
That's huge.
Cooling the blood moving from the neck to the head calms the nerves in the scalps that's firing these pain signals to the brain. Then soaking the feet diverts blood flow down away from the head, allowing the pressure on the inflamed blood vessels to reduce. The end result, aside from a cooler head and cleaner feet, might just be a headache-free day.
Wow, that's excellent.
How simple
that's
is
awesome.
That? And this is that's a
easy.
Good home remedy. It's easy.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? It's common sense.
Mm-hmm.
We go through and think, all right, I can afford some ice, and I can afford a $1 plastic tub at Dollar General. I can put my feet in hot water.
Yeah.
Let them sit there for a while. Do it for 15 minutes and see what happens. And if it knocks that headache in half,
that's huge.
Beats acetaminophen, doesn't it?
Yep.
Which is now the number one cause of liver failure in this country. So, I mean, little things like this work very, very well. You can find these on Facebook. If you get a chance, go there and look us up. We had a great time, guys. Enjoy the weekend. The weather looks like it's going to be very, very nice. We'll join you next Saturday once again. I'm Dr. Sean McCaffrey. Our show here is called House Call. I want to thank our sponsors, Apple Barn, Belterra Farms, Gracie Baja, and the Body Quest store over on Montvale. Remember, guys, if you don't expect a miracle, they tend not to happen. Bye-bye.
Oh, good night, sweetheart. Good night. Good night, sweetheart. Well, it's time.